On November 2nd, 1982, the New York Times issued a correction. They had incorrectly reported that a Rubik's Cube had 3 billion possible states. That was way off. The correct answer was about 43 quintillion. That's more than all the grains of sand on Earth. But the New York Times really can't be blamed for making such an egregious error. That was the tagline. Rubik's Cube, over 3 billion combinations, but just one solution. Apparently, the ad execs didn't think 43 quintillion was as catchy. By the time the New York Times had issued its correction, somewhere around 300 million Rubik's Cubes had been sold around the world, making it very likely the best-selling toy ever made. Maybe even one of the best-selling consumer products ever. Until the iPhone, that is. But why? After all, it's just a cube, with each side made up of 9 smaller cubes. Unlike some other popular toys that came before it, it wasn't electronic, nor was it remote controlled. It wasn't from a movie or a TV show, not yet anyway. It wasn't even supposed to be a toy at all, not originally anyway. Erno Rubik built his cube in 1974. Variously explained that it was meant to be a teaching tool to describe three-dimensional design or algebraic group theory, the truth is Rubik made his cube for no reason at all except for fun. The fact that it was a puzzle soon became apparent. Once he began twisting the sides, the cube became a jumble of colors. But Rubik did not know if it had a solution. If he kept twisting randomly, it would likely return to its original state eventually. Whether that would happen in his lifetime, or anyone else's for that matter, seemed doubtful. We now know that it would take 3 centuries of everyone on Earth twisting their very own Rubik's Cube to eventually return one to its original state. It took Rubik a month to solve it. This was Soviet-era Hungary. Rubik lived on the other side of the Iron Curtain. Consumer fads just weren't a thing that happened very often in a rigid command economy, even the relatively lax goulash communism practiced in Hungary. So Rubik had no reason to believe that his cube would become a worldwide sensation, much less the most successful toy in human history. In fact, Rubik was fairly certain someone else must have already invented it. It was just too much fun to be the first of its kind. Nevertheless, the cube would make Rubik a contradiction in terms, a communist millionaire. In another twist of fate, a Western toy manufacturer came across Rubik's Cube and saw potential in it. They brought it through the Iron Curtain and gave it the capitalist treatment. The cube debuted at international fairs and drew a fair amount of attention, but didn't really hit the big time until its television premiere. On the 4th of July in 1980, the TV airwaves were flooded with 30-second spots highlighting Rubik's Cube. TV commercials were supplanted with newspaper ads. By the holiday season, Rubik's Cube was being advertised in 100 markets. But it wasn't just advertising that led to the cube's popularity. Many people found the cube's puzzle just as alluring as its creator did. The popularity of Rubik's Cube even led to a mini industry in itself. How-to books ran up the bestseller lists. ABC Television produced a cartoon show based on the cube. The race to solve the Rubik's Cube in as little time as possible gave birth to the sport of speed cubing. In just a couple years, the Rubik's Cube craze died down and was surmounted by E.T. merchandise and video games. But no toy to come would surpass the cube at the height of its success. As of 2015, the iPhone had sold 700 million units, about twice as much as Rubik's Cube. But that's over a decade. Rubik's Cube sold around 300 million units in 3 years. The Sony PlayStation has sold something in the neighborhood of 400 million units, but again, over a much longer period of time. There's Coca-Cola with 1.5 billion units sold every day. But then again, you don't consume a Rubik's Cube like a soft drink, so it might be an unfair comparison. The Rubik's Cube had a bit of a revival in the early 2000s, but its heyday remains in the early 80s. But with 43 quintillion possible combinations to solve, the allure of the cube will be certain to keep us puzzled for years to come. Special thanks to our Patreon patrons. Without you, the good stuff just wouldn't happen. So if you like what we do here, go on over to patreon.com/thegoodstuff and become a supporter. Otherwise, you can like and subscribe to this channel, hit the notification bell so you know when the next video is coming out, and I'll be back in a couple weeks with a new video. Thanks for watching.